How to Survive Middle School, a book written by Elizabeth Fee, along with some other educators. It's a whole series. Thank you so much for talking with me here today.
Happy to be here, Kim.
So your thing is world history, right? The kids must be going crazy with world history right now. We're living in some interesting times, aren't we?
Yeah, to say the least.
So tell me a little bit about how you came to work on this project, how this book came to be.
Well, I was working in Brooklyn as a staff developer, and you know, it's one of those things where who you know sometimes works, and somebody put out a call for a friend of theirs who happened to be the editor, wonderful editor of this series, Dan Tucker, and he was looking for educators to write these volumes. And so, you know, I put my name in. I'd always wanted to write a book. I loved teaching world history. So this all happened well before the pandemic.
I mean, wow. We
didn't actually envision this project as a tool to help with learning loss, but that's exactly what it's suited to do right now. So
yeah,
the timing is quite interesting for the release of it, because when I began it in December 2019, you know, who knew what was coming?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, taking a look at you, like when you were in middle school, what was your life like?
Well, you know, in a way, like middle school was back then pretty much the way it is now, right? You know, what you care about.
That's what you care about. And that's very much the same for the kids at my middle school now. But I think, you know, right now the stakes are higher for learning than they were for me in middle school. Now there's competitive, you know, admissions to high school, colleges are getting even harder to get into. And then you add to that the learning loss that we all knew happened from the pandemic. So, you know, I think kids are under more pressure now than they were when, say, I was in middle school. They're still kids, they're still resilient. But I think that, you know, our challenge with this series was to draw in kids who are increasingly engaged digitally. As we know, their devices are taking the hours away from their days. And it's having an impact on their ability to progress and focus. So I'm actually happy to see a paper book going back into kids' hands.
Yeah. And I what I love about it is that, like, when I was coming up, you know, middle school for me was like the worst. It was socially, it was the worst. It was just the worst experience in my life, in my all of my school. And that kind of can interfere with learning, you know, and that's what I love about your book, is because I could have curled up with this and learned something. Like I didn't need to, it'd be an addition to what I was getting in school, but it would be something that would be of value that I could use. So this is for what, 6th to 8th graders? Talk about the book, because when I was going through it, I mean, there's illustrations, there's graphs, there's charts, there's diagrams, there's formulas. And that was another aspect, visually being able to see the words with what the illustration, it just makes everything so clear.
Well, and it's a must for this age group, right? Because
yeah,
they're growing up in a visual age.
Yeah.
And we knew that, I mean, I know as a teacher, like if you put like big chunks of dense text in front of a 6th grader, they're like, yuck.
Yeah.
You know, they don't want to do that.
Memorize this.
Yeah, horrible. I mean, yeah, you know, that's miserable. And it's not really even real learning. So yeah, we did make sure that the format was attractive and that there weren't long, dense paragraphs that kids would struggle through. So it's broken up nicely with the illustrations, but we've also included charts purposefully, because this is a great tool that teachers use, right? Like
yeah,
up on the whiteboard or on their PowerPoint. Like, charts are so important for kids when they're learning. And then we have what are called their survival tools, which is a cute little gimmick that's actually really empowering, is for kids to be reminded to use these thinking skills that we introduce at the beginning of all of the books, you know, whether it's like the hiking boots or the pickaxe, like
yeah,
it's the metaphor is like surviving the wilderness of middle school. And I like it because kids need catchy ways to remember things. And so when they get to the pickaxe, right? Like that's signaling them to look closely at this particular line, really think about it.
Right.
Why was this set? Why was it set in this way? And P.S., it aligns with the Common Core standards. So I feel like what we've tried, all of us, all of the authors, we've tried to put our best teaching into these books, as well as the best information we could have in the most engaging way for the kids.
Yeah. When did you get interested in history? Did that start when you were in school, or did it start in college, or what?
Actually, much later, I'm sorry to say. I mean, I did have a really good seventh grade world history teacher.
Yeah,
I won't
too,
forget
me
Mr.
Too.
Hofschmidt. I mean, it was taught traditionally, but I remember being interested. I would say really when I got into it was as a teacher, because I was an English teacher. And then my principal said, well, we want you to teach humanities, which means you're going to teach history as well as literature and reading. And I thought, oh God, I have to, but I was learning with the kids.
Yeah.
And, you know, I studied ancient Egypt and ancient China, and it was just great, great fun. So, and I also was a history student even writing this book. Like I taught ancient civ. I didn't really, know all that much about, say, the Renaissance as a teacher.
Yeah.
So I got to learn all of this and engage in my own learning process, and then convert it into a way that I thought kids would find it interesting. So I feel kind of lucky. It was a really fun project.
You know, in reading through this book and just the way that it's taught differently, obviously, than when I was in school. I mean, I would have learned so much more. I think I've interviewed different people who have magnet schools or charter schools. And when I went to school, it was all memorization and it was all dates. And like, I don't remember any of it. It wasn't put into any kind of context. And in the book, you put things into context. Was that intentional? I mean, there had to be a great deal of thought that went into how this book was structured, because I've never really seen anything like that before.
Well, I guess I already knew that that's what the best practices were for teaching social studies and history, that it's okay. Very much reading and thinking based, and that there does need to be a thoughtful context for things that always makes connections to the present day and that looks for patterns. So yeah, I mean, I don't think I would have ever done it any other way, because also we're in a different age, right?
Yeah.
Like information, it's easy. You know, you pick up your phone and you can find out anything you want, and so can kids. But really being able to understand that information, to process it, and also discern which sources are valuable and which ones aren't, and a lot of them aren't, that we felt was really important. And so my editor actually added an extra chapter once the manuscript was finished around thinking like a historian and being able to be really savvy to internet sources.
Yes.
So I'm proud of that too. I think kids really need it.
Yeah, you can definitely be proud of this book. I mean, for a teacher who's watching or a parent who's watching, who's maybe trying to figure out like, how does my kid best learn? What's the best way for my kid to learn? How do they discern that?
I want to say it's not going to be by force, right? Especially middle school. I mean, you can bribe them to a certain extent, but what I often, what I feel about this age group is that middle school kids, they're very passionate. Right? Like they really get on about something, and then it might be something else, but they have this great enthusiasm that's natural at this kind of volatile age they're in. So that's what I always tell parents, and that's what I always try to keep in mind as a teacher, is that let's find out what the kid is super interested in and then use that as a springboard. And that's why I think like the whole series, I picture it, on kids' bookshelf, they can dip into it when they're jazzed about something, whether it's world history or it's science or it might be English language arts, they can explore their interests and dip into the sections that are really going to feed what's already passionate in them and then give them more. So, I think it's laid out ideally for the age group, and yeah, it'll replace the learning loss, but I really want it to grab kids' interest.
Yeah. And the book, you know, that's the thing is that you'll never know, like the book has to be in the house. The book has to be in the house in order for a kid to stumble across it and be bored out of their head and just start reading and like be mesmerized by it. You know, want to visit some of those places that you talk about in the book. I saw where you said that it was, or it was understood that high intensity learning, the summer school programs, that they produce results, but they're too expensive. Yet something like this is summer reading. I mean, and it's not big, long, drawn out chapters, right? You can open the book.
No, not at all. Yeah. Yeah. It's meant to be that way. And I think that, you know, it is the kind of thing that we want kids to want to do it on their own to a certain extent. And that's also really appealing to middle school kids, right? Yeah. Like the beginning of it says, the front of it says, beware, this book might make you smarter than your parents. Like that's what they want. Yes. Right. And this is, and our sort of, our approach with them is like, hey, you can do this.
Yeah.
You know, take out this book. You can, you got this. We're your guide. We're going to take you through it. We're going to show you some cool stuff. And we're going to teach you some survival tips that you can use on into high school and college. And it's really true. I mean, these reading skills are things they need. And we're presenting them in a way like, hey, you know, let's give you a leg up here. And you can do this. You got it.
Yeah. I mean, art, the series, you got world history here, but you've got arts and literature, right? And what are some of the other ones that are available?
Yeah, there are four others. There's English, written by a great friend of mine. It's really a brilliant book. There's a science volume, math, and then there's American history.
Yeah.
So we got it covered. We got the core subjects all lined up there. Yeah.
Hey, I just noticed we both have tulips in the back.
I love tulips. Yes. So,
wonderful thing about May. What's your favorite part of this? You must have some favorite stories. If you can't pick one, maybe a couple of them.
Well, I do love the first chapter because it's setting up for kids what history is in a way that they might not have thought about it. And I think that it frames the book. Probably my favorite chapter, you know, which is both the content as well as like some of the fantastic illustrations and things I learned a lot from, was chapter 5, Late Modern History, that talks about revolutions and especially like the impact of the slave trade.
Yeah.
So that kids really understand that like a heinous institution, like enslaving people, actually built our country and had effects worldwide that are overlooked. So I just felt like that particular section was incredibly important for kids. You know, and it talks about imperialism. It has an interesting part about Japan that was really fun for me to learn about. I didn't know about it. So
I like Egypt.
Me too. Yeah. I do love Egypt. But that was old content for me because I'd studied it so much with my kids. But yeah, it's
as soon as
great
I got the book. As I got the book, I went right to Egypt.
I know. Middle schoolers love that stuff with the pharaohs and stuff because it's real. It's hard to even believe that society existed.
My seventh grade history teacher looked like Nefertiti.
Oh, cool.
I remember telling her, her hair was all slicked back. I remember saying after school one day, I'm like, you know, you remind me of Nefertiti. She's like,
amazing.
Thank you. She was like considered the most beautiful, you know, her face was sculptured and all of that.
Yeah.
Well, this is, I can't say enough about it. I too got into history way too late. If I would have had this book and maybe a different teacher as life went on, it would have just drawn me in because it's, you can kind of see where you're going by taking a look at where we've been.
You said it.
So
you
this
said
is
that
available
so well.
In bookstores and of course online at all your different available outlets. And then where can they reach out to you? Where can listeners, viewers reach out to you?
Oh, well, you know, guess what? I've finally gotten on social media. I'm dating myself, but I have started an Instagram account where I'm going to be posting some things in ways that, you know, kids can have a little bit of extra that'll guide them through the books. And then of course, you know, Random House as Random House Kids, which is an Instagram account, they can find out about the whole series there. And you know, this is on sale everywhere. It's not hard to find.
It's a fun book.
Yeah.
How to Survive Middle School, a do-it-yourself guide. This one's World History, Beware. This book might make you smarter than your parents. I'm sure it will. Thank you so much for your time today, Elizabeth Fee.
All righty. Thank you, Kim, so much.